everyone. Welcome back to 996 The Howl. Let's start with the big news from yesterday. The headlines. Valimaki signed a one-year, $1 million contract with the Coyotes. Pretty bare minimum contract. You know, 1 year, $1 million. You can't get lower than that, basically. But it is actually a pay cut for Valimaki. He's coming off a contract signed with his former team, the Calgary Flames. That was 2 years, $1.5 million. He was a former first-round pick, 16th overall in 2017. So, yeah, he did take a pay cut. I'm sure going on waivers and leaving Calgary was pretty rough for him. He said he wanted to find a home, and he has found a home in Arizona. He says he's loved it here, and I think that's why he took the pay cut, just as a prove-it sort of deal. We're going to have to rely on Valimaki and Moser together once, you know, if and when Chychrun and Gostisbehere get traded. Valimaki and Moser are the top four defensive pairings in the league in terms of expected goals against, playing a minimum of 200 minutes together, which is pretty remarkable considering the team they're on, and especially the past 14 games where the Coyotes have lost 12 of 14. So yeah, I wouldn't praise Bonchon too much. You know, it's a good signing. We'll see if Valimaki proves it to the team and gets rewarded with a bigger contract after being relied upon in the last stretch of this season and next season. What, you know, sort of bothers me, not bothers me, but is in the back of my mind, is last year, sort of the same contract was signed near the end of the season. Bill Armstrong signs Dyson Mayo to a three-year contract worth $950,000 one way, which means he's getting paid that even though he's even playing in the American Hockey League. So, you know, that was a bit of a blunder contract. I know last season down the stretch, Mayo was like an impressive D-man. I didn't like the way he played in front of the crease, but he was serviceable depth defenseman for about $1 million. I was fine with it. And now you look now where he's not even on the team anymore. He's in Tucson. He had a rough start to the season. So I'm just, you know, it's a bad taste in your mouth for depth defenseman signing. But I think Valimaki is going to outperform Mayo. He's got that offensive awareness. He's getting better. He's getting more chemistry with the team, like I said, with Moser. I like him. He's a very good two-way defenseman. Doesn't pinch. Doesn't, you know, start the rush. He's got a good pass, first pass out. Makes good plays with the top line. Could get shots on net. Not an amazing shot, but sort of like a Moser light type player. And if we could rely on both of them, once those trades happen and they perform well and he gets more power play time, it'll be a really good contract. And then I'm sure he'll get a raise after this contract is done. The other big news is Miloš Kelemen making his NHL debut. 6'2" prospect, 23 years old. They signed him as a free agent, I think, last summer. He's been playing in Tucson. I loved his game in the prospects tournament. Just an energy bunny. A big guy, hard-nosed grinder, just gives a bit more than Carconi. I think Carconi is like a one-dimensional type player. I know a lot of people like Carconi. For me, you know, Carconi's 26 years old. He's an older prospect. I don't really see him as a future. Like I said, one-dimensional. All he has is that top-end speed, and sometimes he burns the opposition, but I don't really see anything else from Carconi. You know, doesn't crash the net well, doesn't play along the boards well, doesn't, you know, play that grinder physical style, whereas Kelemen could be that. We didn't see much of him last night, only played 10 minutes in the game, one shot on goal, but that's expected when it's a type of game where you're trying to get back in the game and erase the deficit you find yourself in. Turney was playing the first two lines pretty much the whole game and rarely saw Kelemen. But hopefully, you know, he plays a couple more games here if Kraus and Michelli are still injured, or if one of them even come back, maybe Cassian sits out and Kelemen's in. I would love that deal where Cassian's in the press box. But, you know, we'll keep an eye on Kelemen, see where he's at. He's wearing number 21, Louis Erickson's number, which is funny. So hopefully he does better under that jersey number than Louis. Getting into this, back to the game last night, you know, I didn't hate this game. There's a moment where this game fell apart in the early second period, but they didn't look flat coming out of the game, you know, out of the gate, you know, a couple good shifts, a bit back and forth, both teams, you know, using their speed, getting some chances. It's starting to get away from them a little bit. They're being outshot 13-5 in the first period, but they didn't look flat. They didn't look out of the water. It was the type of game where you're like, you know what, this will probably be a back and forth game. Both teams are young. It'll be an energized game. So it was one of those games where we really couldn't look away from the game because, you know, it's the Anaheim Ducks, 5 wins, well, 6 now in regulation and almost 50 games played. So there's a chance that Anaheim could have fumbled the lead, which they almost did. And we remember all those crazy comebacks in that shortened season where Cowboys would come back against the Ducks. It seemed like clockwork. I remember one, Dvorak got a couple goals. Chychrun had awesome games against the Ducks. So you had to stick and watch it, unfortunately. It didn't turn out into one of those comeback games. But they're down 1-0 after the first. And then the second period, they didn't get a shot for 12 minutes, being outshot 14-0. They get a major misconduct. Valimaki gets ejected from the game with another sort of weak game misconduct call. I didn't agree with the Keller one against Ottawa. This one, I don't really agree with it. Yes, it's a penalty. You know, it wasn't violent, egregious, maybe a bit egregious, but the player wasn't injured, no blood. It was a retaliation. He was upset that there was a mixed call. The guy elbowed him in the face. So, you know, just like Keller's, if you call the penalties that that happened right before the incidents, these incidents wouldn't occur. So that's just where I'm at with the Keller one. Cross-checked in the back twice, which you're not allowed to do. No penalty called. Keller takes into his own hands and gets a game misconduct. Valimaki, elbow to the face, no call. Slashes the guy from the back. Game misconduct, I guess, and apparently we're a goon squad now. So that major penalty happened in the early second, 5-minute power play. They actually scored on delay penalty, and then they didn't take time away from the penalty, which I've never seen before. Usually, when you call a major penalty, the play stops dead right away. You don't wait for possession. So they score on the delay of penalty, but still give the full 5 minutes. They didn't give it a 3-minute power play. And then the Ducks score another goal on the power play. They end up getting 6 shots. It just kind of ruined the mood for the game for like 15 minutes. And then near the end of the second period, Coyotes start, you know, finally getting out of that bad mental spot. A couple good shifts, the top line circling around the O-zone, doing their top line magic. Going into the third, they started the third well, good as well. Bukestad and Gunther had a couple chances too. I'm loving Gunther's chemistry with Bukestad. I'm worried that once Kraus and Michelli get healthy, that chemistry is kind of going to get dissipated and separated. I wonder what they're going to do with Gunther once Michelli gets back. You can see him maybe go on the third line, but you know that's not a recipe for success if he's playing with Richie and Boyd or even Fisher. It could be like a Gunther McBain Richie line, but still hopefully Gunther performs well on that line, or maybe he fights for the spot on the second line wing. We'll see. You know, the 2 more games left before the All-Star break, Michelli might not play in the last 2 games, so maybe that's a problem for another couple weeks. But you know, they start the period off good. They get down another goal to make it 4-0 Anaheim, which was a goal against momentum. And then the Coyotes finally break the shutout. Barrett Hayden with an amazing deke and roof daddy job on the Ducks goaltender. They make it 4-2 on the power play with Schmaltz. It looks like it could happen. And then they pull the goalie 4 minutes left and the Ducks make it a 5-2 game. They didn't really hate the game, just that brief moment in the second period where they got no shots in 12 minutes. Yes, they had the 5-minute major, but that's only 5 out of 12 minutes of hockey. You had other 7 minutes where they didn't do much, and the Ducks kind of took over the game. But if your team tank, it was a good game to lose. Now I think they're 2 points ahead of Anaheim, 3 or 4 points ahead of last place Columbus and Chicago. So the gap did shorten. I said in previous videos a couple weeks ago that, you know, we'll see at the end of January how the gap is. Even us after the All-Star break, we'll actually see and start to dive in with like games in hand, points percentage, how teams are separated, and it's pretty close that it's the bottom four teams of Chicago, Columbus, Anaheim, and Arizona. San Jose might be pulling away a little bit, but they're not too far ahead of the Coyotes. And Vancouver won last night. They got a new coach, Rick Tocchet. So that little new coach bump should put him on a streak that takes him out of the bottom four or five. So two more games left, St. Louis, and again, Anaheim. We'll see how it goes. I want to see, you know, more of Kellerman, see what he's about. Maybe he has a different, gives the team a different look, because the bottom, like, six, I know they don't play with the bottom six on the forward core, but the bottom five players, pretty much when they're on the ice, you're not expecting a goal. You're not expecting, like, offensive momentum. It seems like Tourigny is only sending out the first two lines to do the offensive damage, and they can't do it all themselves. They're missing the depth. It's so obvious that this team is missing Michelli and Kraus. Kraus has missed, I think, four games now, so hopefully he gets back in these last two games. Or Michelli, they could. We don't know. Gostisbehere also got injured last night, and I haven't seen a report yet on if he's actually injured or just had to leave the game for soreness. It seems like he took a body check to his arm. Hopefully it's not broken. Hopefully it's not severe. He is a trading piece for this trade deadline, so if it is a long-term injury, that kind of ruins the plans for Gostisbehere and trying to acquire more picks. So hopefully all is good with Gostisbehere. We'll see. But yeah, a pretty rough game, but you know, it's good for the tank. And you know, it sucks that they've lost 12 out of 14, but they got two more games left before a big break, and maybe they could recharge, re-energize, get some healthier bodies in the lineup, and get back to the ways they were in December and November and October for the start of this season. So that's it for me. Thank you for watching. If you like what you see, spread the word. And as always, thank you for your support.